interpretation of it. We have a very broad spectrum of work which we're involved in. I am part of a group of consultants that work under the label of Midgard. That's an Old Norse term for Middle Earth, the domain of humankind. And it's in this area that we work. And all of my work is based ethically on the Earth Charter and has been for many, many, many years now. And Miriam asked me to come and share with you today, particularly on climate parks, a response, an integral response to climate change, but actually the same solutions for all of humanity's dilemmas, all of the questions that we are facing about global citizenship, about biodiversity, about global warming and cooling, about too many pollutants in our food, our sedentary lifestyles, all of these woes that we've inherited from the industrial era and mistakes we made a long time before that. My organization and my particular personal passion has been to find solutions, practical solutions. They also involve education, so I'm very involved in education of the Earth Charter, how it's applied and how it's lived, but I'm particularly interested in the living of it. We don't have time anymore for 10-year academic studies on what we're doing wrong. We ran out of that time 40 years ago. Right now, what we need is global citizens acting like they belong here on Earth. And our educational programs are geared toward that direction with a real sense of urgency, so we don't wait till all the studies of how a coral reef is dying in Mozambique before we start to apply sometimes imperfect remedies. But we have endeavored to create whole models, and I'm here to share with you today some of the models that we are doing globally, in South Africa, some in the United Arab Emirates, some in Italy, one proposed in Norway, in Myanmar, on the coast, and elsewhere around the globe, where we've had efforts to fully manifest the intentions of the Earth Charter. People are hungry now, not just for an ethical base, but for the how to. How do we, with the right urgency, act for our own food security, for securing our water, for keeping global temperatures inside the zones that are helpful for us, to plan for the eventuality that we might not get that right? What do our cities of the future look like? What do our local municipalities look like? How do we meet our needs for energy responsibly? How do we manage our water? And how do we educate people towards this end and motivate them towards it? My thesis in short, and I'm going to make it a little longer now, but in short, is without a model, a living model, that people don't just learn about, but actually live in. The house they live on, the road they walk on, the way their water is cleaned in their neighborhood, how they produce and participate in the production of their own healthy, chemically free food. All of these elements conspire towards what I consider intelligent, integral design systems. They happen also to be the best way to respond to our crisis of climate change and all of the fundamental, the foundations of our Earth that we are shaking in terms of life support systems. Many of them appear to have even gone too far, but there are ways, and life is a robust thing. And we work right from the biochemistry down from the molecular level through the microbial life as a foundation where we brew in highly damaged regions effective microorganisms that bring life back to the soil using waste that is otherwise thrown away to start the healthy metabolism of the planet coming back. Where coastlands are affected, the best pioneer species is a mangrove, and I'm going to talk to you about that. There's many other kinds of water-based plants but the mangrove tree and all of its varieties and forms is the true pioneer. It really, it protects our coast, it provides environment for fish populations. It's also aesthetically beautiful. It creates opportunities for production of fish on a high level to feed populations. It has a cooling effect. It's one of the best sequestrators of carbon that we know. So this plant performs on all sorts of levels. And historically, it's seen us through all kinds of challenges. This is not the first time that this planet is facing warming or cooling. And we periodically go through these things. And what I've made it my business to study is how the whole system of life conspires to create resilience and provide the environment for more abundant life. And it does it dominantly through diversity. We've worked in many ways politically at reducing diversity in our histories and caused all sorts of problems with ourselves. So there are many reasons to mimic nature, to find out how, for these millions and millions and millions of years, that the earth has cleaned our water. So when we treat wastewater for a city or a municipality, we use plant-based technologies, constructed systems that mimic a forest floor and a riverbed system and a riverine system and a mangrove swamp, to even take chemicals like mercury out of suspension in the water. And combined with the right microbial life, these are more robust and more efficient and require no energy component when compared to modern engineering systems. And they've been tested for 3.85 billion years or so. You can't question that kind of research and development on the planet. And we have some bright person at a university or out of an engineering company saying, "Hey, I've invented a great new system to sell you." We want to test it against the intelligence of our planet, of how our water, in Africa, you can have a hippo dying in a river, or here you have a crocodile or a snake or anything dying, a deer dying in your river, and you can drink the water a kilometer downstream, and you don't get poisoned. How does this happen? How does the biochemistry convert something incredibly toxic and harmful in the short space that it does into something that you can hopefully ingest? These are the questions that we've been asking ourselves and all the other thinkers on this subject globally, and we've been putting it together into a design system which has as its basis the Earth Charter, which gives us a wonderful checklist, ethically and otherwise, to make sure that it's fully integral, that it includes all the questions people ask about fair participation, that it includes the economic imperatives, that it includes all of sentient life. And the Earth Charter is the first global document that is of such a high order that it doesn't prioritize nations or humanity alone. It puts us together as we should be in one healthful system of life. And our design systems for our municipalities, for our cities, for our universities, all of these community arrangements that we have for sustaining our lives, the food we eat in our cafeterias, all of these things should be linked, and they can be modeled quite literally by walking into this jungle behind us here. Then you have the oldest, most experienced personage or sentient life system on the planet with no gardener that has been cleaning water, turning dead animals and diseased humans into food for the whole system of life for a very long time. And it's these lessons that we need to learn and put into our new design systems of life. If I can, I'm going to give you, and this can be very complex, so you'll excuse me for just don't try and understand all the words and the systems. Try and see the patterning of what I share with you now. I'm going to share with you the theoretical model for integral design. If we design our cities as climate parks that are going to clean our air, clean our water, provide us with the real economy. Do you know that economists on an economist's accounting sheet, that all the natural systems of life are listed as externalities. That's the label. The foundation of life is external to our economic life. Now, that obscene notion, that outrageous egotistical blindness to the context of our life, has only occurred in our immature phase of human development, where we've considered ourselves like a spoiled child, alone in the world, and able with technology to express ourselves, change landscapes, take minerals out of the earth without questioning any of the linkages. And as we've developed in our humanity, we scientifically and spiritually, morally and otherwise, cognitively, we start to see that these are very real linkages. And even our selfish economics are not served long term if we don't consider all of the tenets that are represented in the Earth Charter. And those foundations we need to bring. I use it as a design template. So a design of a climate park, a community program, a municipality, an academic institution, for me is not complete unless there's a check next to each tenant, each principle that is found in the Earth Charter. And we have a number of others in addition to that, because design is a very sophisticated thing and you've got to bring about a whole community. But that is our foundation and our primary checklist. We then look at it in terms of, is it integral? Now this word integral means integrated. Does it belong on our planet? Not will it work on Mars or the Moon or somewhere else. Does it fully function and is it integral with the systems of life? Fully integrated, plugged in, adding life, not harming or taking away from it. And this might seem like a very obvious thing, but it is something not very often found in design systems. So I'm going to take you back to the beginning now and have a look at integral design systems. And don't worry about all the other technology, words there, but it is transdisciplinary. It's not just interdisciplinary. It's a system that synthesizes and takes a whole view of all of the academic perspectives, all of the methodologies available to us, all the major ones, and the Earth Charter's intentions, and we've applied it in, tested it rigorously in many, many different environments. I must honor Ken Wilber, a controversial philosopher, but the integral system is very much part of his work. But right back in Plato's day, also not the most popular philosopher, but many of the thinkers, Plato, Kant, and others, have come up with these three major truths. Plato called it the beautiful, the good, and the true. And he meant the beautiful as in the eye of the individual, so the design needs to look after the individual. The good, the design needs to look after the common good. And the true, the design needs to make sense in the rational, empirical, environmental world, the things we can touch and see and measure. Kant called them art, morals, and pure reason. Habermas called them, dealing with groupings of people, called them subjective, intersubjective, and objective truth. I'm going in the wrong direction here, sorry. But all of these are true in their own way. And a spreadsheet for developing a climate park or doing a design that is fully inclusive includes these four quadrants. So this is the horizontal plane. This gives us, without the depth, it gives us our checklist. Have I considered what is considered beautiful, artistic? What is the individual and how are they nurtured and looked after in this design system? the we, the good, the morals, or the collective truth, that intersubjective truth? Have I looked after and have I calculated the weight, the objective science? Have I not excluded that, the things that we can measure, the toxicity, the chemistry, taking things down to an atomic level, the individual microbes, the individual plants and animals? All of those elements have to come on to your spreadsheet. They have to be accounted for, because if they're lost, if they're considered an externality, then we are living external to life support systems, and we are not contextualizing. We are not living in the real world, the actual biosphere that influences us long term much more than we can influence it. The IT systems is the systems science, the interobjective truth. And that is well mapped now in academia. We talk about theories of politics and biology, and system science basically has mapped all the external elements of the universe now very, very clearly and showed how they relate to each other. But that mapping must not be mistaken for integral mapping. It is only one quadrant. It seems enormous in its scope, and it seems to show all the connections. But academia, as it currently offers system science, offers it as an external mapping. We know how everything works in terms of functions. What we must not leave out is our good, our morals, our ethics. And this is what we are constantly reminded by the Earth Charter, to include those internal elements that make us human. But they're not only internal to humans. There is an internal, very complex DNA to a functional forest, to the whole biosphere, to an ocean, to a coral reef. That is a holding pattern. It makes that system of life create balance in itself. Have you ever thought about that? Why does a forest never have a gardener? And never need one, unless a human goes and drops a seed from another continent in the middle of it and starts to disturb that evolved relationship on one space. There is a patterning there. It's a dialogue that is audible to all of the subtle complexities of this one system of life. And it wills itself to more complexity all the time, keeps adding life, so that if there is climate change, if it does get hotter or cooler, or if there's disease or too many predators of one kind, that it is still robust. And that's what we need to pay attention to in our towns, in our cities, in our food security programs. We can't just think, is there enough bread on the table? Is there enough milk? Is there enough water? We need to think about how complex and how evolved these relationships are, and how important they are to keep that complexity. Or we not, we become more vulnerable. Every time another species dies off on the planet, we are also more vulnerable as a species, because it's part of that. And our design systems need to become more complex and more sophisticated. We need to become gardeners, not just engineers. And we need to be integral gardeners, producing a huge diversity of food, caring about the microbes in the soil, and making sure that that's all part of our design systems. Just quickly, for those interested in the academic perspectives that I was talking about, for an integral perspective on anything, to say that you have a holistic view of a thing, a person, a forest, a building, a subject of any kind, you need to look at it through 8 different eyes. And that's the academic language for them. We need to look at it from the eye perspective, the inside and the outside. We don't have time to break these all down now. But very simply, the phenomenology is the way you see the world in your own mind. Developmental structuralism is a Jungian type analysis of how your mind works. And a designer has to think about that, because real people from a real culture are going to inhabit whatever we design. So you can't design amazing systems or buildings that don't take that into consideration. And engineers and architects learn that all the time, because people are going to inhabit that. And they come with a perspective, and they will either use it or not, based on how they view that thing. And so it's a critical element of how we approach our community needs, for example, the way we clean our water, the way we produce food, how we plan our streets. Hermeneutics is a softer internal way of looking at communities. Developmental anthropology, we can study communities from literature. Empirical science, this word autopoiesis, which comes from this region of the world. Autopoiesis is that will that I described earlier. It's that that subtle DNA that makes a carbon atom want to stay a carbon atom. On the social side of things, social autopoiesis is that DNA that makes a community want to stay a community. Or a community of organs, a human body. What makes it hold that form? That we describe as autopoietic in nature. And we have organisms, we have whole systems, we have social systems, which have this kind of organizing principle. And the Earth Charter can have an autopoietic influence over the way we constellate. It can be that template or constitution around which we can constellate as global citizens. And not everybody thinks as themselves as a global citizen. Many of us pride ourselves on our national identity or our family identity. But our problems currently are solved on a whole systems level. We have a systematic problem on the globe, and it requires global citizen and high order, something called vision logic, in terms of thinking and problem solving, to put all of these systems back into a place that that works. I want to just cut through now, because we could spend forever on this subject. One thing that we do need to take into account, and I would encourage any of you who are interested in understanding spiral dynamics, because when we design, we can't design for one population or one individual. Just like in education systems for children, we have stage-appropriate ways and symbols and learning methodologies. When we move through the world, there is a complete spiral, and people are at all different stages, viewing themselves in different lights, thinking in completely different ways. So any model we develop has to include all of that diversity. Everybody has a center of gravity, and we include that. We don't have time for that at the moment. Bar one comment here, which is normally we start out in our early phase as humanity, as a whole group of humans. We looked at things egocentrically. We then progress to ethnocentric, thinking of me and my town, my family, my nation. Then to world-centric, at the time the United Nations was born. Early global citizenship started happening, all of us. And the Earth Charter represents a cosmocentric or all-inclusive. For the first time, we are thinking and basing policy and decisions on all life. Even microbial life, the things we can hardly see, the flora in our stomach. We've started to build ethical, principle-based systems that put that onto our design sheet, onto our accounting sheet. And where we don't, we hurt and harm ourselves. So we need this progression, this elevation, and it is an elevation of view to higher orders of inclusion. We don't have time to go through the psychology of all of that right now. But it is a field of particular interest. If I can go back to one. My particular thesis, which I described in the beginning, is that without all four of those quadrants supported in real living models, our education stays academic. We don't start to truly live it. We might try a few things, but what is lacking is whole systems design, a spelling out of what intelligent of life on earth looks like. How do we care for our needs without eating away our foundations? That cannot remain a dialogue. It has to be etched into our universities, into our schools, into our homes, into our community food gardens, into our national plans of how we feed and how we clean and treat our environment. Now, one of the systems that we've developed for this, particularly because climate change is such an issue at the moment, and I'll give you, it illustrates some of these points in a practical way. Where we go to the coast and start a community program of planting mangrove trees and wetland plants. Now, how we funded that in some occasions is because corporates or nations have to offset their carbon. So they see a value in that tree. That can be the seed funding, no matter morally how we view that as right or wrong. And I have fairly strong opinions against being able to buy your conscience out. However, it provides seed funding to protect coastlines in very vulnerable communities. It provides employment, and it's a starting point for getting your biodiversity back and right in those countries. There's also huge educational opportunities while that happens. Now, it doesn't have to be on a coast. You've got a program for replanting your riverbed here along the way, and Miriam showed me the nurseries the other day. Any body of water that needs to be protected, needs its system rehabilitated, there are economic opportunities there. There are educative opportunities there. The city and the town gets better water, the farmers get more water, and we get better oxygen, there's less flooding, there's more fish in that river, and the same thing happens on the coast you have an eco farm where now there is beautiful diving and fishing on an informal level. Fish populations start to recover. We've had a program like this in Myanmar where we've recovered 16% of the coast through an organization my grandfather started called World View, and 2.5 million mangroves have been planted there. It's created opportunities for community engagement. And then behind that, we start to structure more agricultural processes. So this is building up fish populations, sequestrating carbon. Then we find that orchids are growing on the branches of these trees, and they have a commercial value. Prawns are starting to grow on the roots. Crayfish are coming back. Fish populations are growing. And the community then can feed itself. It becomes part of an informal food security program. And we formalize that with higher intensity, but still ethically based and organic farming processes for fresh prawns or crayfish or lobster. We have salt-resistant plants growing in between for ethanols and biofuels or food production. And then behind that, we start to mimic natural forests with integrated food security programs. 9 tiers of food, I don't have time to go into that detail, but everything from the root crops all the way through to the canopy palms, all of the fruit trees and vines. It's a high density, highly productive and low maintenance farming method that allows children to harvest food for schools and allows commercial sales. It addresses all sorts of other issues. It offers ecotourism, where stilted resorts can be placed into the mangroves or behind them so that sensitive ecotourism can take place. People come and see. It creates edutourism, where people come to absorb. People are approaching you all the time. Can they come and learn from your program? They offer some service like that. It brings money into the local communities and their programs in terms of showing hospitality. This is a systemic and integrated process that allows us to fulfill all of mankind's needs. And it can be expanded to any, this is not just a parochial hippie camp for something quaint on the beach. It is scalable to look after entire populations and we're pushing the boundaries with that kind of development in those areas. Okay, I'm going to take a pause now.
I just want to ask you a question.
Yes.
Can you share with us in which places specifically have you developed or implemented, realized the climate parks in this integration in South Africa?
Yes.
Mozambique?
We've done Benguela Island on Mozambique is my second oldest model. My grandfather started a program in Italy on a family property, and there we have a European model that represents all of these elements that we've been describing. On the coast of Myanmar, which is the old Burma, along there they've destroyed through cutting for firewood and other requirements. The whole coast had become down to 2%. Now back up to 16%, and these programs are rolling out to fulfill that need there. We just started one now on the west coast, 150 kilometers north of Cape Town, with the Silver Leaf Foundation, another whole integral climate park. And we have one which I can't describe because it's still there's confidentiality about the nature of this project by the ruler of a particular emirate. But there we're doing one right in the middle of the Flint Desert in the gravel plains, where the temperatures on the surface are 60 degrees Celsius. And we're creating an oasis there, pumping 13 million liters of sewage, 150 kilometers with solar pumps across the desert, and creating a forest floor and building up a space that will be representative of how we can work against deforestation using only waste to create viable communities and environments for animals to live. We can have questions in detail once we're finished here on the specifics of those projects. But my ambition is to have at least on every continent, and I'm going to push very hard to have one in Costa Rica. Because for me, as an ideal, as a global citizen, around this incredible initiative here, and so many elements. There's already food gardens, there's a river recovery program, there's primary forest that are kindly donated by local families who have the sense of global citizenship and community. There are so many hospitalities. I'm staying at the Hacienda El Rodeo down the road here. Efforts by people to provide us with healthy food, proper cultural experience. You have in this region so much of these beautiful things, and if we can pull that together on a municipal level, we can create a climate park here where students, just by walking around, eating food at the cafeteria, using the lavatory, drinking the water, are starting to understand their connection to this entire system of life.
So if the University for Peace would like to create a climate park, can you show us to that diagram you have, that what would be step 1-3?
Step 1 would be a community engagement process. So it would be first of all to engage the people. It would be in the quadrants, the four quadrants. It would be the individual perspective and the we, the group perspective, to get everybody understanding all the role players. So those from local government, those from the administrators here, representatives of the local communities, educators, yourselves, the student body, we don't design externally and come and impose the solution. So we workshop that design. And we would start by doing mapping how your forest actually works at the moment here, and educating everybody to participate in that particular program. And we would start looking at that, how, and we know there's some sanitation problems here, for example, with high density housing, poor infrastructure. We could start to model that by making sure the university systems of how they clean their water, recycle their grey water, started to function as models. So there would be constructed reed beds. These sort of things can happen very early on in the process. And we would look at the architecture, the urban design, guidelines for people building new houses in the region. And so we would evolve this. We would look at the ecotourism, edutourism that we spoke about before, by encouraging people to come here and learn and to pay for that education that's occurring here. And these multiple incomes, we look at local farmers, upping their production, upping the diversity, linking them to markets because they now have the most ethical of products. And the modeling starts in a very practical way on that level. Obviously, it's incredibly detailed, but we would like to link it to the coast. I know you've got some, you're not too far from the coast here, so we could have associated models that link the whole riverine system and where it empties into the sea, and look at doing a proper program or a system with the proper program that's going now to make sure the biodiversity is correct, but you have a robust approach to that. And then you would have this link right from the sea on the coast all the way back up the river, linking to the primary forest, coming to secondary forest, through to agricultural processes for your own food security program. We'd be learning and linking with your water. We would look at alternatives with wind, geothermal, and solar design, which we go and seek externally. There's many big businesses that need to offset their debt and their social responsibility programs. So the cost of this process does not have to be borne necessarily by the local community. There's so many people out there. The Norwegians are pulling the North Sea oil out of the sea. There's people with consciences all over the world that want to contribute to the people that are taking a lead in these kind of programs. And we would help connect this community with the global community who wants to financially enable that process. And it would be a stimulation for the economy, on agriculture, on tourism, on education, on almost every front that you can think in a normal economy or community-based economy.
Can you expand a little bit on the diagram that you have there? What is it?
Yes, this diagram, as we talked about the carbon investment, is one big area for initial seed capital. But this diagram attempts to show how through building fish nurseries and aquaculture, through having the tourism, all of these things start producing organic food production, organic food trade, organic food through to the cities, the tourism associated with it, local health, meaningful work, improved quality of life, reduced urban poverty. We have people moving away from rural environments into cities all over the world, which is one of our big emphases in Italy. Is this whole ghost towns, beautiful colors on the top of mountains with nobody living in them because all the youth want to go and be in the city where they see opportunities for their own economic life. So this model is to encourage people to move back out and participate in the real economy in the natural environments and to see those opportunities. So there's community resilience from that, the community infrastructure is then developed. And if you look at the progression from the site, you have the individual's needs, which are indicated in the red line, meet the communal needs linked through the blue line, the regional needs addressed through the green line, and the global needs are addressed through opening up flows of healthy food, education, and all of this. And these are the tenets, these are the principles and the intention of the Earth Charter. And of every global citizen, we should be thinking globally and acting locally. But we need to model that. People are confused. There's too much around, and that's why we've evolved this simplified, well, it's not that simplified, I know, but something that can be understood and visited.
Well, the interesting thing is that you have done this modeling in this particular case that you have experienced.
Yes. Yes, it's no longer theoretical. Many places are still sitting, yes, in the future we'll do this, maybe we'll do that. In 2002, we were one of the few groups presenting a whole island system, which could be a whole continent for that matter. It was only 820 people, but we developed this model before then and shared that. And that was my initial engagement with Mikhail Gorbachev and the Green Cross International. They sent people out to have a look at how it meant. Miriam and the Earth Charter at that time. And these nodes and models, if you look for them, are starting to emerge all over. And it's a sharing, an open source sharing of all of these ideas and all this information. And we're not precious about it. So we invite engineers, we invite city planners, come for free, see our model, take the intellectual property. We'll never get to do all the work that's required to be done. So if any of you want to approach us and look at our website, it's still under construction on the climate parks, but we will be listing more and more, doing a joint project with the Earth Charter on sharing these models, how the Earth Charter and its ethics is filtering through and starting to be lived by real communities, real families, and real individuals in their own home, in their own communities.
Let's open to questions and comments, but I would like us to think through and to use you, who is here with us, because there's a lot of talk around the world about the challenge of poverty, the challenge of environment degradation, and a lot of policies and agreements, and of course, it's in a lot of the realization of the problem, and with a lot of difficulty in figuring out how to actually address the problem in a very tangible way in a specific region. So I think you of course have been looking at how to address that in a tangible way, and I think we as a group here should just take the most of your experience in that. So any comment or question?
I was wondering if you've, if you've actually tried it in an existing city, in an urban environment, if you've tried a model there?
Yes, many times. Even the island model that we tried had existing infrastructure, existing processes, an existing approach to the hospitalities. But we have a cities project, which we've worked with the city of Johannesburg. I'm busy with through the engineer department and the business school at Wits University in Johannesburg in South Africa, of modeling this within a city camp, within an academic campus, and bringing it up, which has already all of its structures. So there are challenges in the efficiencies, but there are still abundant opportunities to energize it differently, to landscape it with food, to link it to natural systems nearby, to take out all the ornamental gardening and put only food gardens and food forests in that space. So yes, we've worked very hard at making this so you don't have to tear down the whole city or build a whole new one. There's a big lack of efficiency in that. But we've influenced a lot of engineering companies to start whole departments that are intelligent cities, and that's what they study and look at, re-engineering the way cities meet their needs. And there's beautiful examples globally. It's not obviously just our work. We do our humble part, and we try and influence as broadly as we can the thinking of other institutions and governments and so on to do this work. Yes?
How the model replicated, for example, in Africa, how the model replicated in a large scale?
It's a simple expansion from the middle, and my encouragement is if you have a community project, rather start it very humbly, but start thinking of that. How do you replicate this? For example, in the Myanmar project, it would start with a simple nursery and a few trees just in one area near a river system, and slowly work its way out along the coast. And as it expands and starts to create more income, there's a designed organic growth outwards. And it expands in its scope. There's more fish, so there can be more fishermen. There's more agriculture, so there can be more farmers. Then it reaches a time of critical mass where it needs a school, where it needs infrastructure. We need to clean wastewater from homes. And that's how that model grows outwards. Very much like a normal urban sprawl will happen, but this time it's climate change. It's an intelligent sprawl. The island program I worked on, for example, for 12 years, but it reached a critical mass. We had a 40-bed lodge that was feeding itself, had all of its services provided, and the education component was over within 6 months. It was working. Doors were open. It was offering hospitality. Our educational processes were happening there. I was showing you, shall I show you a picture of it quickly?
Mm-hmm.
You just excuse me while I run through this.
And Bjorn, while you're pulling that up, I also have a question to follow that, what you're about to go into. How can we engage our future generations to be active leaders in these types of integral designs? So if you could expand more on these educational settings.
Yes. What we do is engage the youth in the schools from inception. So when we're doing to make my time most valuable and to be as generous as I can with it, we don't design in boardrooms or closed systems. So we design in a schoolroom. We invite children to participate in actually drawing out the environment. There's an entire engagement process so that the community and the youth are involved in that. And then from their natural questions to allow them to participate, they start this learning. And they truly start to own and understand those processes properly. And we let them obviously come and swim and fish and plant plants, and we do it in their schools and on their school grounds, but invite them to the projects as well. I'm just going to skip through to a picture here so I don't waste any more time. Where are we here? Okay, there's the island. It's about 600 kilometers north of Maputo. When we first went in there, there was a hospitality being offered, but the reefs were being damaged. A beautiful creature called the dugong was almost extinct. We encountered three of them when we first went in there. The country had been at war for over 20 years. They had eaten every living creature. We only saw insects. There was almost nothing left. And so we had to encourage, we found the poachers that were killing these dugongs and selling the meat. And I said to them, I'll give you 50 rand if you show a tourist that dugong. And it changed the person from a poacher to somebody who looks after that animal. They understood the habits, they understood this creature in the best way, and now they're eco-guards. People don't harm the environment on purpose almost ever. They do it in ignorance or out of need. And we shift the educated children that if they understand the habits, they can have a whole career in and a very profitable one there. That's Gabriel Kosa and his son Zito, who back in the day just had a tented camp for tourists that were coming through backpackers. They now financially are dollar millionaires, owning a huge five-star eco lodge that's globally visited by people all over the world, because they were open to experiment with these systems, and we did a partnership with them. We didn't participate in the financial model, so they own that model outright, but with using their land, upping their skills, using the population, we planted vegetables, we set up the educational center, and we offered eco-tourism at a very inexpensive level. There's the dugong. The only viable population of dugongs on the east coast of Africa lives right there outside that lodge. So it's a wonderful story of recovery, of community engagement. The schools have full economic participation, and not in a harmful way. It's all this understanding that through ecotourism, through organic farming processes, through educational processes, these things are all very light on the land. They in fact enhance the land. There's no industry. There's no need for industry there. And everybody's needs are looked after. And it's not a very clear picture, but the swimming pools have reed beds clean the water. There's no chlorine. There's no chemicals of every type. The furnishings look beautiful, but there's no bleaching. There's no harmful dyes. Every stitch there has been woven by somebody locally. We've looked at where the dye came from. Or the carbon calculator is rigorous to make sure that there is a model of how we can do that. And that ministers to a population of about 830 people on the island. And to answer your question of earlier, it's simply a matter of expanding those operations. And it doesn't have to stay with tourism. It doesn't have to be a tourist site. It can be an agricultural community, a fishing community, the hub, or it could be a carbon park, a climate park that was that initial seed. But for it to be integral, it must eventually stand on its own feet and supply all of its needs. It must metabolize or digest or use up all of its waste. And these are principles that are elements of intelligent design. And they're available. And this university could run like that in the community here. So you can have me knocking on your door and pestering you for a long time, because this is where it should happen. Any questions?
Yes.
Yes.
There are major corporations more interested in profit than the environment. How are you addressing that?
Well, that's true. Not all major corporations. There is this general evolution of consciousness, and even the most hard-nosed business people in the world are starting to realize that their foundations, the things that worked in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, are no longer sustainable. They're seeing water as a resource. They're seeing biodiversity. There's a whole new school of thought which we use on our accounting system as what we call real cost to life accounting, where you can give a financial value to an earthworm. You can put that on your spreadsheet, and business people are starting to expand that understanding of what real global economics looks like. And it makes economic sense to shift to renewables, to have a zero waste policy, to not be wasteful. We went through an early period where everyone thought they could just use as much petrol, use as much diesel. We're never going to run out of these things. Figure out the coal. But that's not true. There's a tree falling down this year. And for something to be sustainable, it has to not eat away at its fundamental foundations. There must be no waste in the system. In a forest, there is no waste. In our cities in the future, if we are to have a future, there will be no waste. And that's what everything becomes part of, a digestible metabolism. And big business is starting to realize that that's part of popular culture, so it's not always the purest drives. They're realizing that there's a new market. But that's okay. We've got to work with the world as we find it, not as we would like it to be. We can't be this wounded, wide-eyed idealists in this field. We have to be pragmatic. We have to meet the world in its mess, with its hurt, with its pain, with its wars, and we have to be courageous enough to go in there and actually do something. Don't just talk. We need to do. We're in that age where global citizenship is acting locally. We do our thinking globally, because then we can't affect anything. But we become actors and global citizens. The next evolution of humankind, if there's going to be one, and life is precious, we cannot take these things for granted. Somehow we'll find a way. In our immaturity, we have those kind of feelings that it'll just work. There's been massive extinctions in the past of almost all life. And we're teetering on the edge of that. So there is an urgency about becoming actors now. Influential global citizenship. And there's a design template for that, and it's called Integral. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Have you in the project, some conflicts. So could you share an example of how you could overcome
conflict? Very important question. It's a constant issue up front where you have conflicting interests. You have but let me give you a very simple answer to a very complex question. And I'll go back to that spiral dynamic that we talked about, to analyzing the internal. Maybe I'll show that to you again, because it's a very, very critical thing to understand. Bear with me again. Thank you. researchers that have looked at the whole development of humanity. And basically, we still have representatives of, on the earth, if we include children and all sentient life. We have an expression of consciousness, a level or worldview, of every worldview that has ever existed on this planet. From the most simplistic survivalist reptilian brainstem, through to the early emergence of the limbic system, where we felt emotions like we see in a horse or a dog, through to the triune brain, which we see in some of the primates, early phases of that, and expressed in humanity. And we've gone on to progress and develop that mindset. And many, many conflicts are not cultural at all. They get looked at as cultural. And I have a huge exposure to this in South Africa all the time. And many times they are developmental worldviews. They are conflicts based on where we at in our own personal development at the moment. And it's totally cross-cultural. Now, these cross-cultural studies have said that in every community, we start out as a child in an archaic, which they represent with infrared, survivalist, trying to learn to walk and eat and motor skills, and move through to a magic phase, mythic phase, and there are correlates in our cognitive development. We move through concrete operational in childhood to formal operational. We don't have the time to cover these in detail, but you can look up any of those researchers, Gerhard de Graeff, Piaget. I'd happily share that with you. Conflict, to come back to it, is not just resolved through dialogue. Often dialogue accentuates the problem. And it, linguistics, our language gets in the way, but it's not our cultural language that we speak a different tongue. It's that we see the world through a different set of eyes altogether. And when I say freedom, it means 20 different things in this room to 20 different people. And we think we come to an agreement on how we're going to express our freedom in a community. And we use the word, but we don't go down to the depth of how does the world look in this spectrum of consciousness. Now, a man named Donald Beck did 63 consultative visits with Nelson Mandela in South Africa and coined the term the spectrum of consciousness, which in its original form, by agreement with Nelson Mandela, wasn't a plain this way of culture and color. It was a common spectrum where we can engage people wherever they are at in their own development and encourage development to higher orders and higher views, more inclusive views. Because compassion starts very late in human development. We romanticize hunter-gatherer communities, for example. And I work with very beautiful hunter-gatherer communities, with the Inuit and others, but in particular in South Africa, with the San Khoi. This is 10, 12,000-year-old tribal system. But to see the world through those people's eyes, to understand those linguistics and engage, is a very, very complex thing that takes time and to work with. So the conflict resolution is done best in the short term for building a model like this through understanding the perspective. And let me give you one practical example. I was working in St. Lucia Wetlands Park, the biggest wetland in the Southern Hemisphere, and we had a problem with people cutting down mangroves and other trees. We had people in there from a sort of liberal, political, European background coming in and saying, we should preserve our earth and care about the community of life and all of these terms. And it was having absolutely no effect whatsoever. I sat down with some of the leaders in that community, and the spiritual leaders in particular, and looked for those, what is sacred about a mangrove tree? What would cause this particular worldview to want to look after that tree? And it wasn't just the tribal community that was cutting it down. There were business people chopping it down to launch their boats. There were, I counted, 5 different worldviews. And I had to write literature, do an engagement, and have a meeting, and put in motivators. And for those who were at the tribal primal level, the inhabitants of that forest, it was a spiritual imperative that their ancestors' spirit inhabited that space, and that to disturb that space was to disturb their relationship with their ancestral spirits. So the appeal spiritually to talk them to the business people was a whole other conversation. But when we changed that engagement to dealing with the real issue, we overcame the conflict. There was no longer a conflict of interest because we weren't missing the linguistics. We weren't unnecessarily burdening the dialogue with things that are not considered. And we so often feel, and this, the whole field of activism fails often, and I failed many times in this respect, in our excitement to share that we know the answer, this is a better way, and so on. We need to take time to truly understand the perspective of whoever inhabits a space. And to realize that you might have to write 5 brochures. Mm-hmm. There might have to be 3 different curriculums at that school. That the engagement, the employment, all of these things will have an entirely different approach depending on. And when we show that level of respect and humility as designers, as engineers, as builders of cities, as business people, as academics, then we're going to have the response that we're looking for and overcome that resistance. So sorry, your answer is much more sophisticated than that, but that's one aspect of it.
Bjorn, anything very key from the whole, because Bjorn has a lot of information, as you can see, and knowledge and experience, but anything from what you had planned in your presentation that you want to, that you haven't yet shared or you want to emphasize for us before we leave, so that you can boost this opportunity. So like, think about from this modeling of integrated climate solutions for a region. What do you have there in all this presentation that you think it's really critical for us to understand before we go?
The most important message before you go is to start, as Henry David Thoreau said, you want to walk around the globe. He said, start today, go on foot, and go alone. The message from all of the work that I've ever done, I started this project on the Mozambican island poorer than anybody in this room. I can tell you that. And I started with nothing but an intention and a will. I educated myself in real time. I slept on the floor. I bled for this work and this education. It didn't come to me. I had no grant, no nothing. Don't think you can't and now with modern technology, you can express every little bit of learning, as imperfect as it is, you can express it into the whole world right now. But best to do it in your back garden, outside this window box, and do it today. Go and find a seed in this forest. There's some guy named Charles left some seed. Was that you that left the seed? There's a little bag of seeds up the top there. Start taking what you can right now. Don't eat an apple without taking out. My wife at home will not, if I have an organic apple, she'll harvest all those pips, plant them all. Doesn't matter if 99% die or we're in the wrong region to plant them. It's called guerrilla forests. You just plant everywhere you go. We need trees, we need healthy food, and you need the practice of getting your hand back in the soil, out of this mind. The space where we're solving all these problems. We live on earth. If you want to ground yourself, you need soil under your nails, in your toes, swim in the river, walk in the forest, absorb it and do something. Don't wait until you're fully educated, PhD's over, then I'm going to contribute. Contribute now, contribute your imperfection, because honestly, we have nothing else. None of us have anything but imperfection to share. But when we share it, the collective expression of what we will achieve as global citizens, that is astounding. That's where we shock ourselves. So my message to you is to start today. barefoot, no money, no education, don't wait, just start doing something. Don't let a day go by that you don't learn something more about your planet and that you don't express yourself into it. You cannot go to bed unless those two things have happened.